Thanks very much, Madam Chair. Mr. Chu, I'm going to pick up on a theme we've already covered here, which is the effect that your platform, along with many other social media platforms, by the way, has in terms of mental and behavioral health in this country. I won't speak to what's happening elsewhere in the world, but we've talked about the impact that it's having on children, on teens. We took some action last year in this committee to try to improve access to resources, reauthorize critical programs to address mental health needs, but we need to do even more than that. And we got to address what the big tech companies like TikTok are doing, because those are platforms that expose children and teens to additional risks. The more time that middle and high schoolers spend on social media, the evidence is the more likely they are to experience depression and anxiety. And this is particularly troubling, since apparently 16% of American teenagers report that they use TikTok, quote, almost constantly. That's, I think, about 5 million teenagers in this country that are on TikTok all the time. And we know that big tech, including TikTok, uses design features that can manipulate users, including children and teens, to keep them engaged, designed to feed them a never-ending stream of content, keep their attention for hours on end, which includes capitalizing on the desire for others' approval through like features, preying on the fear of missing out through push notifications and so forth. Again, you're part of an industry that's set up to do this. You, in some sense, don't appear to be able to help yourselves in reaching out and finding that new user and then holding onto them. TikTok itself has acknowledged that these features and others, like the endless scroll feature, can have an outsized effect on teens. And we've been discussing today how your app only intensifies that harm by amplifying dangerous content and misinformation. I don't want to be too paternalistic here, because we have young people in the audience. We've got TikTok users that are watching this hearing, and I'm sure they have their own ideas about how this technology is being managed by TikTok and other social media platforms. They like to access the platforms, and they should be able to do that safely, so it's certainly in their interest, and they can drive this conversation, I think, perfectly well. But it's not a fair fight, is it? I mean, the algorithms are on one side of the screen. The human brain is on the other side of the screen, drowning in these algorithms, in many instances at an age where the brain's not even fully developed yet. So those addictive impulses are being sort of perfected by the technology, and again, it leaves the users sort of helpless in the face of that. Are you looking at ways to redesign core features like the ones I mentioned to be less manipulative, and addictive for users? And can you commit to making some of those modifications here today?
Congressman, thank you. We do want to be leading in terms of safety of our users, particularly for teenagers. We were the first to launch a 60-minute watch limit.
Yeah, let's talk about the 60-minute launch.
And I'm very glad to see people, others in our industry follow. For many of your recommendations, we'll study them very seriously. Yeah. We actually have a series of features. Like, for example, if you're under 16, you cannot use a direct messaging feature, mm-hmm. because we want to protect those younger users. If you're under 16, you cannot go viral by default. If you're under 18, you cannot go live. And
let me go back to the 60-minute limit. Because my understanding is that teens can pretty easily bypass the notification to continue using the app if they want to. I mean, let's face it, our teens are smarter than we are by half, and they know how to use the technology, and they can get around these limits if they want to. Are you measuring how many teens continue to exceed the 60 minutes of time on that app?
We understand
how that's working.
We understand those concerns. Our intention is to have the teens and their parents have these conversations about what is the appropriate amount of time for social media. That's why we give the parents what we call family
pairing. Let me ask you this question before I run out of time. If you concluded that putting some reasonable limits in place and trying to find a way to enforce them would lead some percentage of your users to leave TikTok and go somewhere else, is that something that you're prepared to accept?
Yes.
Really? Well, I'd love to get the research on how these limits are being implemented, how they're being bypassed, and the things that you're taking, the measures you're taking to address those issues going forward. Please bring that information back to our committee as we move forward.
I'll be happy to.
I yield back.
Gentlemen.